We are currently searching for a game, and we will be casting that for you. So I will put the brackets on so you can see what the hell is going on here. And also I'll do one more thing, which is putting the chat into my screen in order to see what you guys typing. I know it's 10 minutes delay, but whatever.
So it looks like we're just waiting up for a heel loser once again to finish up his game and a couple other people.
Okay, I'll find out.
Trying to message a few people to get a couple games going here.
Oh wait, I need to... God damn it. Nah. Sorry guys for that square, I don't have brackets ready yet.
Okay, so next round here in round 5, we are hopefully going to be casting Bolivar.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
We have.
Hopefully he doesn't get a buy.
I've opened the witch now, and I see that we have 43 people watching us while we offline. That's extremely good, guys. Thank you very much for your votes. Yeah, exactly. I'm already talking like Donald Trump. I mean, thank you for your votes and all that thing. Well, I need to minimize it. Alright, I will a look at our brackets now. It's already turn round 5 or 4 this time.
It's going to be round 5.
Mm-hmm.
It's just we're waiting on 4 and we can't get into the other games because they're in the last game of the series, and now we just have to wait.
Exactly.
So we only have one more Swiss round, and then I believe it starts the elimination.
That's becoming interesting. Elimination is my favorite part. I love to eliminate. So guys, I hope that now you all see brackets. You have a picture of the tournament. Yeah, there you go. Tournament looks like this for now, and we are waiting for some games to finish. You can see them on your screen. There are 2 games playing, and we are going to be on round 5, then one more round, which is 6, and then elimination part. Are you excited about that?
Yeah. I don't see why you wouldn't be. I mean, we got great players that are probably going to make it to the final. I mean, my guess is in the final it's probably going to be like Nightingale, Tidwell, Bolivar, Mazin. Mazin just beat Nightingale though, so I'm a little shocked by that.
Well, maybe he didn't draw his OTK, but Nightingale just presented us just best beginning of the tournament ever.
That's very true. That is very true. The one KO and then
yeah,
only winning with one HP. I mean, pretty intense.
Yeah. I would just donate him from my first salary. Well, I should say from my salary. And every time you say, you pronounce Bolivar, I am recollecting the song of, what's that? Green Day, Bolivar of Broken Dreams, you know that?
Man, I love Bolivar of Broken Dreams. Oh, I was a huge Green Day fan. I was a huge Green Day fan.
And what
American Idiot album?
Yeah.
Oh,
and
so
now you
good.
Just become a huge dude, right?
Listen. I don't really listen to Green Day anymore, but I'm telling you right now, when I was in, what was it, like 7th and 8th grade? Man, it's all I listened to. Easily all I listened to.
Man, you need to... from what you're talking about yourself, I expect you to be forced to be acting certain way, such as listen to hard music, buy yourself a Harley, and grow a beard.
I just shaved my beard like 2 days ago.
Oh man.
It's getting out of control.
Oh man. Oh god. I'm so disappointed in you now. I was picturing you with that beard. Oh no. I'm kidding. That's all fine. I also love beards, but I'm skinny, so looks awkward sometimes, but sometimes I'm just being a pickup master with that beard. Have you ever learned pickup, though?
Of what?
Have you ever learned pickup, though?
No.
No?
The piccolo, my mom, you know what, though? My mom is actually a music teacher. And she plays the piccolo, the flute, the oboe, the bassoon, all of them. Man.
And how is that relating to my question?
You just said, do I know the piccolo?
No, I ask.
What are you talking about?
I just ask, have you ever considered to read a book on pickup? Not piccolo. I don't know even that word.
I don't understand your question at all. Apparently I heard a totally different thing, but alright. I'm sorry, I'm trying to get these matches figured out for round 5 for us, so that we don't have any waiting time in between.
That would be great, though. So, what about pickup, though?
See, the problem is we don't have any predetermined matches. Like, if we knew who was facing each other next round, it'd be a lot easier. Like, in the top 4, it'll be a lot quicker for us, because, you know, we'll only have to cast a few people.
Yeah. And few people are going to be casted by us. I don't know why would I say that, but I just did. That was good. Now it's better. Oh god. Works. So, are you free to talk now?
Yeah. Sorry.
So, have you ever considered to read a book on pickup? How to pick up girls?
Pick up what?
Girls.
Oh, no, man, I've never had a problem with that.
Yeah, of course you did, but have you ever considered?
I mean, I think when I was in like my freshman year of high school, I think I would have been like more interested in that, you know. But now that I'm older, it really doesn't matter. I don't really I wouldn't even consider it anymore.
Alright, I get your answer, but that's pretty same that because I had the punchline already ready for the joke if you said yes, but alright, you just win that. Congratulations.
So it looks like round four is ending up here soon. Very shortly. I think it finished up. It's going to be finishing up very soon, and then 3 minutes, and then round five will start.
That's great. Well, by the way, maybe some of you don't know, but I do. Jay lives in. Where exactly?
Vegas.
Yeah, Vegas. He already told that on stream, but I am not sure that a lot of you like. Oh man, my cat just started to play with my internet cable. Am I still here?
Yes.
Hey, Mavka. Just drop it. Like, go away from it. No, don't. We might go off stream now because of my cat, though. Oh my. Hold on a second. Have you heard those like more?
Of what, the cat? Yeah.
Yeah.
Round four is still not over.
Okay.
It seems like round four taking a lot longer to end than round three was. Round three went really smooth. This is a rough round for us because we had to restart the stream and the games were already into the third game. I mean,
yeah,
we don't want to stop people from playing their games. You know, I really enjoy this kind of a tournament, the Swiss style, over any other type, because it's a lot more games and gives players an opportunity to come back if they actually, you know, maybe misplay a game and lose a game in a bad situation. I just think this is a much better way.
They still can recover, though.
Oh my gosh. Looks like Heelusion might actually have another tie.
Oh man, no, please don't.
His games have gone overtime every single round. Except for round two.
So, don't ever pick Dark Horse once again.
Yeah, he's my Dark Horse. Hey, he's not losing, he's tying.
Yeah, I know, but still.
He's doing the smart thing.
Maybe that's your ban, you know. Maybe it's your ban.
Hey, listen, he runs green, I think, right? Or what was it? I thought he was running like yellow. I don't know.
Yeah.
I mean, what's best case scenario right now? Mazin is actually up by 3 points on the closest person, who is Zagatir, and I think Mazin actually has a chance. And I mean, this guy seems new to the tournament scene. I haven't seen him in the last two tournaments that I've seen.
Oh, me neither. I haven't seen.
I mean, maybe he's been there, but I haven't noticed, or I skipped over him, maybe, and I don't see him on ladder.
Well, I literally don't care. So.
Wow.
I'm kidding. Of course, we care about you, Mazin, or what's your nickname?
Okay, so we got the next games in.
All right, round five, right?
Yep.
All right, I'm showing our guys. Or the game is already.
It's gonna be. This is a really good game. It's gonna be No Fear versus Bolivar.
Oh man. Right, guys?
Yeah.
Here are.
Number 6 seed versus the number 7 seed.
Yeah.
That's a great game.
So, have a look at the brackets. That's how bracket looks for now. That makes everything understandable and really shows the. Positioning of powers now.
Yeah.
Okay, I hear the voice of in white though. And we are going to get. Oh, Joxy is here. Oh, I need to. Yeah. Just manage all that stuff, right?
Yeah, we're just waiting on for him to accept the invite. I think people went. You know, I went and got a drink or something.
Sure. Alright, so we guys actually taking our sweet time while we wait the another guy who will join the lobby with us, and we start the game right away.
And I think we're just waiting on Bolivar now.
Bolivar? Oh man, the way you pronounce it just makes me thinking about that.
What
song.
Is it? What is it? What is it supposed to be?
I walk alone. My Bolivar of broken dreams, my broken steeds, my broken arm, my broken leg, my broken chest, my broken heart, my... Alright, I want to say something word and then girlfriend, but you can just understand it.
Well, now we're just waiting on No Fear.
All right.
But anyways, so both of these players are very experienced players, okay? This should be a pretty good game. They're both pretty much tied in points. I'm actually not pretty much. They are tied in points on the board. They're both at 9 points in the Swiss right now. Both in ones and sixth, one and seventh, but I mean, pretty much tied. They're pretty much tied for fifth. Nope, they're pretty much tied for third. Sorry. So they're tied with three other people, actually, which is interesting. So let's see this. Okay, so Bolivar is running the classic yellow rush with him. I don't think I would keep this either. He really wants a neutral card in his hand. Wow. Or, I'm sorry, not a neutral card, but he really wants a Kalima's Prayer in his hand, or a Monk, or much more opportunity. That other hand was too mana costly and was not a good position for him to be in, so there was no reason for him to have to keep that. Alright, so here we go. It's a green. So the green deck is going to be looking for a taunt right away against this. He's going to want to get land control established. I think he's going to want to go on either the right or left side with the forest.
Absolutely.
We've seen a lot of people going forward, and it's just not the right play. There's no reason to. Some people do it, and it really is a preference thing, but when it comes down to, like, he's going to get a land there, right? No matter what, unless you draw out well. Okay, so he is playing this. I think we've already seen No Fear play, by the way. He runs the Living
Sorry,
ones.
Yeah, guys, I'm afraid I was too busy with solving another issues that I forget to cast the game itself. So, guys, I apologize for that, and now you can have a look at the situation. So the play the Lance plays like this, and he plays the Willow and to prevent just any rushing from that what that calls the desert. But still, yeah, he does prevent it. So.
Well, that play alone is going to establish a lot on the board for him. So, for one, it's going to not allow him to get the Kalima's Follower up one to get more land control on the board.
Yeah.
And he can't use a Wind Soldier to hit face and put a land down next to face. So that actually does a lot for him in this situation. So, I think that's the right play. I still am not a big fan of the going up one, especially that he did that. He should not have done that, because now he can put a sand on the left side, a desert on the left side of the map, and he's going to use a Wind Soldier here, probably, is my guess, or he's going to double land up the left side, because the Willow's out of position now, right?
Absolutely, and I'm pretty excited to see Wind Soldier here. Because usually yellow decks, they just cut it from decks itself, and Wind Soldier is not really good of a card, but it might get in handy if you play Sacrificial one.
So Wind Soldier, I don't know if I totally agree with you there. So he did do the two planes on the left side like we had talked about.
Yeah.
But The Wind Soldier is actually a pretty good card, if you think about it. It's actually, I personally, when I first saw this card, when I first started playing Faeria, I actually had thought of it more about the Wolf Rider in Hearthstone, you know, where it's a 3-1 removal card. So it's pretty much a 3-mana, 3 removal. That's all it is. But in this situation, it's really good because you can just go face, you can get land control all over the map. It has charge 3. Haste charge 3 usually costs you multiple mana sources, but you don't even need that with the Wind Soldier. So,
but it dies,
all
though.
In all, pretty
well, you can use it as trade, that's correct. But I'm really excited to see it working in Sacrificial deck, as I said. I don't know, I just had this weird mind today during the daytime, so I'm really want to see it working, and especially working showing up by experienced and really good players, not by mine hand that will ruin every single combo I have in my hand.
So that's really interesting that he decided to play the Oakling there, because
Why we don't know his hand.
Well, the Willow just does nothing, right?
Yeah.
Being absolutely. In that position. It just allows it, you know, that gives him perfect. That's why I was wondering why he played the Oakland there, because that gives him position for Vampire. You know you're facing a yellow rush deck. You know you're facing Vampires. Mm-hmm. So it's just really interesting to me because he left the entire left side of the map open. I don't understand why he wouldn't move the Willow over one and maybe play the Oakland on a different side. It's just...
Oh, yeah.
That play is... I mean, it's now 7-8 that he has to deal with as green. He plays a Vergerin Force now, and he has to trade two creatures. That's a, you know, it's a 7 cost for the Vampire plus 3 for the Living Willow that you're going to have to trade, and 6 for the Vergerin Force that you're going to have to trade. So, I mean, you're not getting good value that way, right? And you're losing a Taunt, and that's it's not what you want to be in this situation. So I'm guessing he's going to play another... he's going to maybe kill off the Oakland and see what card gets buffed in his hand and then play a bigger Taunt down, because this is the only way I can really see him dealing with this right now. I think that No Fear is lucky to... I mean, he doesn't know that he's lucky, but Boulevard does not have a Last Nightmare in his hand. So if a big Taunt does get dropped down, the chances are that it will survive at least one turn.
Oh, absolutely. The game itself, I'm not sure. This is like classical already in Faeria. Whatever happens in this game, but mono green versus mono yellow is gonna be a classic.
Yeah, we've been seeing a lot of that today. So that does give him a turn. Oh, that's a good draw for him. That was actually a great draw for him, because now he can kill a Living Willow. But is it even worth it at this point? Maybe you just do the Living Willow now, take the damage off of off the Rune and Shrine. I don't know. I think there's a couple of options he could do here. I mean, maybe if you kill the Living Willow with Choking Sand, go face with the Vampire, and then Wind Soldier, kill the Rune and Shrine, get it off the board, because that's actually a big deal. You need to get that off of the board.
I'm also excited about seeing Choking Sand here. We were telling before that they usually attempt to cut Choking Sand now, and if that happens, though, that's pretty rare to see the this card in the deck. So
I think we are going to see the Wind Soldier onto that. It just makes the most sense in this play. Because you need the Rune and Shrine off of the board no matter what. Oh, he's going to play the Zealous Crusader, which is interesting because he doesn't get much value from that. But he does put a lot of pressure on the left side as well with a Mana Source, so he can get 2 mana from this if he goes up over a Killer Rune and Shrine, Choking Sands the Living Willow, go face.
Yeah, absolutely. Just go face. Choking Sand isn't the played yet, but there is the...
I'm sorry?
Yeah, I'm just thinking, don't worry.
So, I think that that's the right play. So if he kills the Living Willow, what does that allow him to do? It allows him to get face damage, right? Worst case scenario for Boulevard is that a larger Taunt gets played straight down in between the Vampire and the Oakling. I think that's worst case scenario.
Absolutely right.
So he does decide to go for mana control on the right side, which is really intriguing, because what is he even going to accomplish on the right side? Okay. Wow, that is close to worst case scenario.
Yeah, absolutely. And this is like now 6-12, which is insane. Absolutely, and now it's off the range of Choking Sand, so this card is becoming useless now.
Yeah, I think what's going to happen is he's probably going to play a Kaleem's Follower, hit face, Yep. So he played the Kalim's follower, hit face. I mean, it's the only value he has right now on the board, and the Living Willow is way out of position. Yeah, it's like, it needs to be over one tile. I know he's getting mana in that position, but it's just, it's still out of range. He's going to be getting face damage here for at least two turns against yellow. But the green player is still in a good chance here, because Bolivar still has yet to not draw the last Nightmare that he really needs right now.
Yeah, but regardless to that huge creature, it's far away from the orb and protecting it too, so that might be sort of bad. How do we say that? Dark side of it.
But this is actually problematic for the Living Willow, because now he can just move the Kalim follower over or gain mana, put the Zealous Crusader up.
Absolutely.
Okay. So that's fine for... I don't really think he's in that much of trouble, because he was going to have to trade the Zealous Crusader no matter what.
Yeah.
So I think he trades the Zealous Crusader into this, and Wind Soldiers trades the Vergerin Force.
Yeah. Maybe you...
puts the Steam Forge over.
Absolutely. Oh, man. You can just wrench kill it. Well, like, through the time. Well, not really. If Willow will be placed on the left of where it is now, then almost every initiation of attack will be just denied by that.
I'm trying to think here why he decided to do that instead of trade it.
Oh yeah, I wish that Bolivar would draw some damage in order to sort of wrench kill his opponent.
I mean, I'm still a little confused as why he decided not to trade into the Vergerin Force. I personally, right now, in this situation that he's in, I'd play the Malevolent Spirit behind. Oh, but he decides to play another Steam Forge. Is he trying to bait an attack onto the Zealous Crusader? Because if both Steam Forges live and the Living Willow goes over one tile, he can trade both Steam Forges into it, but...
Yeah, but he really wishes to.
Well, his other problem is mana, because if he had 6 mana, he's going to have 3, 5... I guess he could have 6 next turn. Play both Wind Soldiers, trade him out. But now he's going to lose his entire hand and board. I'm still a little confused as to why that was played that way, but hey, I'm not playing this game.
Yeah, and you pretty much regretting it, right?
No, I'm loving this.
Man, yeah, of course you don't play this game, you play Counter-Strike.
No, I just watch Counter-Strike, there's a difference.
Yeah, I know, but you know how I'm creating the punchlines out of one setup? That's the mark of a genius, yo.
Well, so what is this play here, right?
I didn't know.
What is the yellow player?
I guess draw plays concede.
No.
No? Oh, God.
He still has a chance in this game for sure.
Yeah, but look at that. Kalim's follower has no attack, so he can't trade.
Yeah, but that's the trade isn't really what he's looking for. He's looking... He can trade it no matter what, right? He can just play a Wind Soldier.
Oh, man. That Kalim follower is huge now.
Well, I think what he's going to do is he's going to hit with the Steam Forge, right? He's going to hit the Living Willow. And then Wind Soldier into it as well. Trade that out. Hit face with the Kalim's follower. Play another Kalim's follower. Hit face. End turn. Or Soul Drain.
Yeah, you Soul Drain just cycle, I guess.
No? So, what did he decide to do here? I think he's doing what I just discussed. Yep, so the Wind Soldier trades into the Living Willow. He's gonna play the Kalim's follower here.
Into Windborn, into trade?
No.
No?
I mean, no, he doesn't have enough mana. He could Soul Pack, though. But yeah, he is going face, just like I had said. There's no reason to do that. You could do that next turn, right? Because if he has another Living Willow, he has Choking Sand to answer that.
Absolutely.
His biggest concern right now is probably Grove Guardian, right?
Grove Guardian? Well, yeah, probably it is. But still, you have an answer on that. No, you don't? Oh, you actually don't.
On what?
You can't answer Grove Guardian.
I mean, it would just pretty much delay things.
Mm-hmm.
You could draw into it. I mean, I'm sure he's running Last Nightmares. It's not a game-ending card, but it's at least a four-turn delay.
Yeah. Oh, man.
The problem comes when the green player, if he's playing Breath of Life, because if you have Breath of Life, the yellow player's really hurting in this situation.
Yeah. Oh, my kid has come. George.
Well, that's a really good card for him to have here.
Yeah.
The Imperial Judge is gonna farm mana like crazy here. It's gonna pay for itself within two turns.
It was in free, though.
Wind Soldier hit face Kaleem's Prayer?
Well, Wind Soldier, Windborn, maybe? Windborn hit face?
Yeah, yep. So he's hitting face, Kaleem's Prayer.
Oh, so Soldier Drain. That's well. Huge.
Well, but the question is, does he Soul Drain the 7-1 or the 1-1 gathering 2 mana each turn?
I guess you don't care about mana.
Well, now he's Orja Monk face here.
Oh, man.
What a great series of draws here.
Absolutely. But I still kind of regret that. Oh man, no. In this case scenario, you better Soul Drain 1-1.
That's actually weird to me that he decided to kill the 7-1.
Yeah.
Because the 7-1 really isn't a threat right now.
Well, actually 7-1 would do nothing.
That is a threat.
This is a threat, absolutely. But no.
So he's on a 2-turn clock. He's got 5 damage in hand.
Oh no, he's got more now.
It's 2-turn clock.
Man, he has little, no? Oh no, he has no mana. Well,
no,
he won.
2-turn.
If the opponent does not heal, he won. Now what he needs to do is deal all the damage, which is not distant. So basically,
yeah, he needs to play the monk
and
the follower.
Yeah, with Windborn, for example. Yeah, and then make your opponent low enough so you can kill him with a spirit next turn. But also, yeah, you also need to gather. Can you gather here? No, you can't gather mana. Unfortunately. Oh no, you can. By placing monk here. Yeah. Oh no, he's doing the exact opposite.
Interesting.
Yeah.
But I mean, if you're playing as the green player, you're already anticipating the Malevolent Spirit, right?
Absolutely. But still, I kind of missed the fact that Wind Soldier would die at the end of the turn. So that's why I said that it's better to sort of kill that 7-1. But clearly it was much better to kill the... Oh
wow.
Man! The game
wow,
is sealed,
what a turn
man.
Of events.
Wait. I am not sure that draining mechanic is working...
It's close. He has to draw here.
Man, come on. I guess he just ruined his game.
Not necessarily. I mean, he's got 2 more Kaleem's Prayer in his deck, so he's got a 1 in 6 chance of drawing into the Kaleem's Prayer here, right? So
yeah.
If he does Aura de Monk face and draws a Kaleem's Prayer,
yeah.
Plays it on Aura de Monk, it's his only out. Okay, so he needs, he lost. GG.
You know, I have a question.
Yeah.
You see, that spirit says that you drain free life your opponent. His drain mechanic is exact mechanic as damaging. Oh man, he draw. He's
true, but he doesn't have the mana for it. It's still GG. Yeah. He was looking for another Kaleem's Prayer into
Nightmare.
And that even wouldn't do it. But he was looking for... He didn't want to have to draw yet. He wanted to draw with the monk, Kaleem's Prayer into Kaleem's Prayer into Nightmare, and he would have had enough mana.
And No Fear wins it now.
So 1-0 No Fear.
Yes, that's correct.
Great game. I mean, that was really close. That was a total blindside by No Fear.
But like, I'm still curious. Is the drain mechanic works exactly as damage mechanic? Because if it's not, he could
yes, it
heal
does.
His. It does.
Yeah, if your god takes damage on the rune and shrine.
But it's not like taking damage. Draining. Well, I don't know.
I understand that, but Soul Drain doesn't proc. I mean, Soul Drain procs it as well, so I would assume that the Malevolent Spirit would proc it as well.
But you are familiar with Dota, right? Like, in Dota, there are. It used to be 6 different type of damage. And it was like pure damage and like damage itself, and it was draining. Or health removal, which was not counting as damage, so health removal would not trigger some like abilities.
Oh yeah,
I
totally understand what you're saying. Yeah, it's just I know that Soul Drain procs Rune and Shrine, so
yeah, Soul Drain. Fine with Soul Drain. That the fact that these two cards have a word drain in their text does not make the cards work on exact same mechanics, right?
They both are lifesteal mechanics and they're both the same kind of damage.
Really?
Yeah.
I guess not.
Because you steal the life from them. It's the same thing.
Yeah, but
this is a great start and for the green player.
I agree. The reasoning which I use is that you have to point the old drain, but spirit drains it automatically. The reason the question is it scripted that way that he automatically points the god, or if it's just another mechanic? If it would be, that would be just a win for him. We don't know this kind of stuff, and you know how insane would it be if a player actually wins because he or she knows that. That would be just insane and mind-blowing.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know how that works exactly, but I am almost positive that it's the same mechanic as Soul Drain, and that no matter what, the damage procs first on the Rune and Shrine. So, I'm almost positive. But anyways, back to the game. So, this is a great starting hand for the green player against Yellow Rush, and he knows he's facing a very generic Yellow Rush deck, right? So what he could do here is he could play the Wood Elemental down, put it on the left side, and play a Forest down on the right side.
Yeah. Well, usually what I try to do with this deck is like placing 2 Furious on the sides of my orb, and then just place the Wood Elemental. Place the Forest, then Wood Elemental, and create the Forest on the side of another Faeria, and play something into there. This way you just starting accumulating Faeria from second turn in quantity of 2, which is insane, and gives you a lot of value and opportunity to just do whatever you with your game. Yeah.
I understand what you're saying in that aspect, but you know you're already facing Yellow Rush. You know, you already played 1 game.
Yes.
And so there's no reason to play like that. Because now, I mean, even with this right here, this is not where your minion wants to be. You want to be... The taunt needs to be in the middle next to the god's face, and you can stop him completely from gaining any land control by going to the left and right hand side. So this is an interesting play. What he could do here is play 2 planes on the left side and block out that desert, but then that still leaves him open to any haste creatures because the taunt isn't in position.
Hmm. Okay. Oh no. Did he just skip the turn as Yellow Rush?
Hmm.
I guess he did.
No, no, he played the sand down. It was Green's turn.
Oh, alright.
So this is the right play, like we had talked about, putting the two planes down with the taunt in position in the center. Living Willow on that side is a little interesting.
Oh man.
Vampire yep, has see come. That once again. I don't understand. This has happened in a few of these games. People just forget about Vampire.
Mm-hmm. That just happens. People get maybe tired already. Because it's a fifth hour of this tournament.
Oh yeah. I mean, I myself am getting a little, this isn't even my sleeping schedule, so I'm getting a little, woozy,
yeah. But
we're doing our best here. It's, this position is just really awkward now for the green player because he allowed the vampire to suck from two different sources, and that's just, it's not something you want. Because now what do you do in this position? You need to get pretty lucky. You Elderwood embrace like one of the taunts and hope. You Elderwood embrace and Runin's one of the taunts, and you're literally hoping at that point. So he's trying to save his Living Willow here for at least two turns of a mana source, which I guess is smart, but it also leaves the left side open here on the next turn for the yellow player to get some face damage in on the left side.
The point.
Yeah, I think that's the play. You do Oakland and defeat the forest, because you can at least survive by three turns here with the Tiki Healer, the Runin's Command. I mean, I believe you can.
Oh man, I guess my chat is already jumped.
For what?
Well, it just stopped. That's what I say.
Oh.
Don't worry about that, but there it is, he is on 2 turns clock though.
Yeah, definitely on 2 turn clock, maybe even a 1 turn clock right now.
Oh maybe, yeah. Well, absolutely.
Oh no, for sure a 1 turn clock. I mean, if you... So what happens here when the... I mean, what's the best case scenario? He plays Tiki Healer this turn? Gets 5 HP? I think that's the best situation for him. Oakling in to feed the forest here? Yeah, I think that's the play. You do Oakling in to feed the forest, because you can at least survive by 3 turns here with the Tiki Healer, the Runin's Command. I mean, I believe you can.
Oh man, I guess my chat is already jumped.
For what?
Well, it just stopped. That's what I say.
Oh.
Don't worry about that. But there it is, he is on 2 turns clock though.
Yeah. Definitely on 2 turn clock, maybe even a 1 turn clock right now.
Oh maybe, yeah. Well, absolutely.
Oh no, for sure a 1 turn clock. I mean, if you just looked at the start, right? The green player played both of his taunts adjacent to each other.
Yeah.
Around a desert. How do you expect not to get vampired in that situation?
Ah, man, it's a lot.
But I'm pretty sure this game is over. I don't really see any out for No Fear. I mean, best situation, he plays Tiki Healer, Runins this turn. Goes back to 20 HP, the 7-10 Tiki Healers on the board, but then you don't really have a better solution after that. So So there we go. Here's the Tiki Healer, and I'm pretty sure he might Runins here too. Or if he doesn't find a reason to Runins, he might not. But I could see a Runins play here. But next turn, if he wants enough mana for Verdure and Forest or Tiki and Elderwood Embrace, he wouldn't play the Runins. It's just Runins is more of a safe play. Because if he has the Last Nightmare, he could have Lethal here. With a Kaleem's Prayer. So he Last Nightmares the Tiki, hits face for 14, and has a Monk in hand with a Kaleem's Prayer, just like this, maybe?
Yeah. Oh, Nightmare. Last Nightmare. And this is game.
Is everything going to happen that I just said? Okay, GG. I mean, that's what I was saying. That's why I would have personally Runin's Command, right?
Yeah.
Would have been out of range of that kind of a play. But still, it was just delaying the inevitable, you know?
Absolutely. All right,
so we're doing 1-1 here. 1-1.
I gotta add something white, right?
Yep. Alright, let's make him player one. Alright, let's go into game three. We're tied 1-1 right now. No fear, the blue player versus Bolivar, the yellow rush player. Two totally different aspects of playstyle. One more slow methodical, the other one kind of fast and rambunctious. Alright, so this hand right here, I mean, it's not ideal. I would say he's gonna mulligan it. Oh, beautiful. You're looking for that Kalina's right away. This is a beautiful start here for Bolivar. He's gonna just go and Steam Forge and Forcer up there, and if green doesn't have an answer for it early, it's pretty much just gonna be game.
Yeah, absolutely. This game is all kind of kind of bad because of the hand. Not really happy of that, but yeah, you can start with Steam and Forge and Forcer and just do.
Well, that's why you pretty much mulligan for that Enforcer. Like, you really want that card in your starting hand, because this is the play. You do the same thing every game, right? You play two prairies, and then you play a card. That's how it goes. It's not like the green deck where you need to plan out how many lands are down, what's going on, how much mana control you have. So it's really important for you to get that Steam Forge and Forcer quickly. Okay, so far we haven't seen an answer yet from the green player. So what's the worst case scenario here for the green player? He doesn't have a taunt? If he doesn't have a taunt, it's pretty much just over here.
Pretty much over. The yellow rush already had that attacking position, and now Kalim's Prayer maybe, or...
It was interesting to me to see that the green player tried to play aggressive here at the first couple turns with those prairies.
Yeah.
It kind of set him back to get anything going in his hand, because green players need those lands.
Yeah, need those defensive lands, to be honest.
Yeah.
And then it's lethal next turn. I guess you concede.
Yeah, this is just a disaster moment for the green player.
Yeah, well, he took a risk He wanted to over aggress. How to say that? Yeah. Overreact, maybe. No. Yeah, overreact probably it would be a nice term here. He wanted to overreact the opponent. Say, you going to face me? No, man. You don't expect me playing like this, so I'll just take a bigger risk. But probably I'll just end up winning somehow.
Well, that was a good recovery here so far by the green player. Magda into Feed the Forest. That's all you can really do at the moment, right? Wow, I mean, the position right now for the green player is just bad, because any position where he could put a taunt on the field is taken. That's why you saw him fill out with that desert there.
Mm-hmm.
It's a smart play, because now the green player is on a 2 o'clock timer, and he's got to take care of the Kalim's follower, and then the Zealous Crusader. See, it would have been a lot better if that desert wasn't there for that Grove Guardian, right? But instead, the Grove Guardian's going to be out of position for at least 2 turns, and I think it's just lethal.
Probably. It was like threatened little from the second turn. Well, after he played that Kalim's follower and discard the Crusader. Oh, he healed up. Double heal from ruined comments. That might save him for a little while, but I don't really expect this game to be a win can be won, considering that fact. Oh, Kalim's follower is just insane.
Once again, just puts it in position. The green player is out of position again. You can't place any land there. There's no way to taunt something that he really needs to. Like the Zealous Crusader is going to put at least 2 turns on anything like a Grove Guardian. Okay, there it is. So, oh wow, that was a good draw for him too. So he could actually wait a turn here, or he could go back with the Kalim follower. Wow, he decided to just take that. That's good for him.
That's it.
Hmm.
3 mana, 3
cards. I think this is just lethal.
Yeah.
Because even if he kills the Zealous Crusader, right, he's got Windborn for the Kalim's follower to win. Yeah, GG. Alright, let's look for... Alright guys, sorry, we're just getting a few things straightened out here. Mm-hmm. All right, guys. So it looks like we have another streamer coming in.
Yeah, a little bit of change because it's pretty late in Jay's hometown. Well, Vegas.
Well, Joxy's coming in to cast, and he's going to be doing that because the final, and he's going to cast the final anyways, but we figured he could come in earlier and take my place. But hey, listen, I really, really, really appreciate you guys at Coil Gaming. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
You're welcome. First time casting. Yeah.
And I really enjoyed casting with you as well. Thank you, everybody, and have a great time. I hope you enjoy the rest of the stream. It's been a great tournament so far.
Sure. So... see you later and keep in touch. Bye. And guys, Joke is on a way to come and take the slot of the Sawcaster with me for future games. Hey Joke, how are you doing?
Hey, I'm good. Just got home from work, basically.
Nice. Alright, I'll reduce some music volume and put it a little bit louder.
Alright.
But, alright, you're done. You're very loud now.
That's good. I've had the problem before that I've been too silent, so I hope it's gonna be good now.
Yeah, I've done my best to help you with that. So we actually need to find the game to be casting. That's on our brackets. Let's see. We have to update that. I'll send you a link for the brackets so you can just suggest whom to cast, whom do you wish to cast, which match would you prefer.
Alright, let me take a look.
Yeah, sure. And
so we are in round 5, right?
Yeah, I gave you a right link. And I don't see how bracket is settled myself, but it will be on my screen just a moment later. We'll see. And I also put it on stream so people will see what the game is actually.
Alright, great. So what are the options here? Which games can we choose to cast?
Without the scores. Whatever without the scores. So Squiddy or Maltic. Yeah, those two games do we have. And we need to contact them on Discord chat in order to...
Alright, I would definitely like to cast Squiddy.
Wait, alright, so we just find him on Discord and that's it, and talk to him. What's his nickname here? God damn it. I don't know. Alright, fine, I found him.
Squiddy, that's Squiddylicious, right?
Yeah.
I've been watching his stream a little bit.
Oh, what can you tell about him?
Let's see if I'm not... just gonna open his stream quickly so see that I'm not mistaking him from someone else. I've been trying to... watch a lot of streams lately. I go and say hi to people when they stream Faeria, and sometimes they're like the more famous players or the higher ranked players, and sometimes I also like to watch the beginners and maybe give them some advice. So yeah, Squiddy, I saw him actually play, I don't know if it was 2 days ago or so. I was sitting with my daughter on the couch watching him on TV. When he was trying so hard to get into God rank, he was just one game away. He lost, fought back, lost, fought back, and then he went on a three. He lost three games in a row, and I felt so sad for him because I know how frustrating it is when you're so close and you just want to get there. But then he finally managed.
That's great. That's the story of prevailing, you know. I need to add that guy, so I need to copy his nickname with the... I can copy it from here, I guess. Oh god. I hope I copied it. We'll see. No, I did. Oh yeah, I did. Nice.
So, how long have you guys been playing so far?
It's already 6 hours. Well, it's 5 hours 24 minutes for now.
All right.
Pretty long tournament today, yeah.
Yeah. So the Swiss rounds, they're also best of three. Is that correct?
Yes, that's right. And the people have 8 card sideboard, which is like used a lot.
Okay. So I'm taking a look right now, and it seems like we have a lot of... I recognize a lot of the people who are in the top here, and I'm not at all surprised. How many people will go on after the Swiss is over? Is it 4?
Yes, only 4.
So right now it looks like Sagitter, Tidwell, Mazin, and Simon are the highest rated players.
Guys, we're just having our time in order to find the deck game to just ask for you. Oh, wait. All right.
Have you seen any like really crazy decks today? Anyone playing something very unexpected?
Yes. Nightingale tried to guess what he brought.
So can you tell me a little bit about this deck? Now I'm very curious.
Well, he actually brought an OTK deck and managed the win like really crazy in the like fourth turn, I believe. He managed to make a creature 23 attack and just flesh winded to opponent's orb and just OTK'd with that. And that was the first game of the tournament, and we were just so excited to see that. And on the other game, on the second game of his match, we found out that his opponent also plays exact same deck. Well, with some of the variations, of course.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we see that OTK battle like two Jedis, you know. Because, in the fight of Jedis, almost every hit is mortal, right? And here it was the same thing, where two people just trying to OTK each other.
And, that sounds really cool.
Yeah, they built, like, strong, castles around their orb of creatures in order to prevent that OTK thing to come.
Yeah, I wonder if any of them are maybe running some structures with taunt in their sideboards. They can be very, very powerful against those OTK decks.
I've seen those. I've seen, yeah.
Because sometimes when you play those types of deck, you only really get one chance. And
yeah,
if there is a big taunt structure in the way, you'll lose too much time and the surprise factor.
Mm-hmm. Actually, the second game of that Nightingale and Mognic was a little bit back and forth, because at the Mognic really got initiation in that and left Nightingale with 7 health point mm-hmm. for the whole game, and then Nightingale just damaged himself to 1 HP through Soul Pact and still managed to win.
Oh wow.
Yeah, you surely should watch it on WOT later on.
Yeah, I definitely will.
I need to make players add me.
Yeah, I'm excited to see some games. We gotta get it started. Come on.
I'm trying to, but they already like started games and all that thing.
Alright. So anyone else than Nightingale that brought a very interesting deck so far? Have you seen, what did you see most? Is it the Rush?
It was green-yellow every time.
Green-yellow, Sacrifice, or?
No, some of Sacrifice, some of not.
Alright.
Alright, I need to add people. How do I add? Add people. Alright, I understand. So, we need to see what the brackets show us now, and probably it's already around 6, and if it's so, oh yeah, is that, no, it's still around 5, yeah. So guys, I'll show you the screen of brackets. We are waiting for this last match to finish, I guess, because of players, they already, I guess, started. Do they? Did they?
I don't know.
We need a multi. Do I have multi? Yeah. Yeah, I have, but he's not responding to my friend requests yet. Just sad. I can write him in Discord directly. I don't see him on Discord. Alright. Multi. To end that guy. Alright, so basically I'm waiting for a response of both of the players. in order to make their game casting. And well, that happens. We can talk about something else. Just well, tournament. For example, went for Rickard. I believe. No, not yeah. It will hit a new record today of stream length. It will take much more time than previous Lunar Rumble. And how do you feel about that?
Me?
Yeah.
Well, I wasn't here for the last one because I'm always working on Wednesdays. So, I mean, I'm not really influenced too much. I remember I was a bit tired after casting last time.
Absolutely.
But you can see it in two ways. I mean, longer tournaments means more content for the viewers to watch, and also more time to play for the players, which is nice. But it's also nice when it's a bit shorter, I feel. Sometimes the viewers just simply don't have the time or the patience to watch too long tournaments, or it's when you watch tournaments and stuff, it's really nice when there is as little downtime as possible between the games, usually, so you have more action.
I can rely on what you say. That has truth in it. But it's kind of impossible when players are not that, how to say that?
If they don't respond to you when you ask to cast them, there's nothing really you can do about it. And that's also a little bit frustrating, because it's not as fun for the viewers. And if you want to host tournaments and stream them, it's important that you get the viewers so that you feel that it's appreciated, so you can continue doing it and so on.
Mm-hmm. Well, we actually have viewers, that's one thing. But, alright, BattleBot. Alright, we actually have our top 4 bracket started, I believe. So now we... Is that? Cool. Yes, we have matches, so Tidwell, I give you a link.
Yeah, I see it. Tidwell versus Messine and Sagitter versus Simon.
Let's go on Tidwell.
Yeah, he's a very good player. I'm very excited about watching him play.
Can you give me a short quick guide how to... Alright, I found Tidwell and whom?
Messine.
And I also need to invite you.
Yes, please.
Yeah, so how do I... can you give me a hint? Okay. This player one. So we actually on the game.
Whoever you put as player one, that's the player's hand we're gonna see. Do you know what deck Messine and Tidwell are playing? Do you remember from the previous rounds?
Not really. Wait, Messine somehow.
Maybe they're doing sideboard. They might be just editing their decks for the sideboards.
But they can do it here, right? Okay. The also kind of dark side of the Faeria that you can't just type people in game, so that actually makes it a bit awkward.
Yeah, that makes it a little bit tricky in these situations, but I'm sure Abracam is working on different ways of making tournament hosting easier.
Finally, we get our first game. Sorry for that delay, but it is here.
Alright, so we already see Messine with some yellow cards in hand, mm-hmm. and also the defender of the homeland. Do you think he's gonna keep this hand?
I guess not. What can you do with that?
Well, the defender of the homeland can be placed already on turn one and start collecting already next turn.
Well, it
and the vampires
must be placed close to you, right?
Yeah, but...
You can move it. Try it.
Yeah, so he wouldn't be able to summon anything. I mean, collect anything earlier than turn 2 anyway with his hand.
Regardless to what I say, he still just keeps that hand. That's interesting. So we know that another player plays green, but it might be green and blue. So anyways, playing those two decks, you still want to actually start with the forest in front of you, no matter what, because you know that a lot of people on this turn play just yellow, whatever variation they use. And he drawn the event, though.
Yeah, that is a very powerful start for Tidwell to already have his Flower Silk Fairy triggered. This makes it very hard for Massine to just take out with a vampire.
Yeah, and also it will gather two Faeria per turn, which is insane. And this is the main goal of the green deck. Usually you want to establish a Faeria advantage, you want to establish a board advantage, and that's the perfect start to so take over the game.
Yeah, but now I see Tidwell placing a lake in that position, which makes me a little bit worried for him in case, because certainly next time it's Tidwell's turn, he's going to move down the Flower Silk Fairy. Mm-hmm. And Tidwell will probably play another land, and if he plays a creature there...
No, he didn't.
Tidwell now builds another land downwards and plays a creature there, the vampire will be able to hit both of them.
Mm-hmm. That's correct.
And he could even make double vampire.
Oh man, that would be insane.
Yeah, but I think Tidwell is very aware of the vampires. They're pretty... Yeah, so he places his lake a little bit to the side to avoid standing next to the mountain.
Oh, whoa, that's something coming.
This fairy is absolutely very difficult to deal with.
Well, we've seen today how people forget about vampires and they just put two creatures very close to each other and next to the desert, so vampires get insane value out of it. But we see that Tidwell does not do that mistake, and also this buff of embrace on the area. We've seen people doing that, but also we need to mind the fact that myth color is in the deck, and it might deny value of this embrace.
Yeah, I think a big reason why he chose to play the embrace is, of course, to get the Darkstalker out, but also taking the fairy out of Shocking Sands range.
Absolutely.
So now Massine. No, it's not Massine's turn.
No.
I think sometimes it's a little bit tricky to see whose turn it is when you're observing. Tidwell sits on 13 fairy, which is quite a lot. There's a lot of... I'm curious. I'm happy to see him play green...
Green-blue, yeah.
Green-blue, it's a very fun...
But here he's going to freeze, right? Yeah, absolutely.
Looks like... Or he might want to deny his opponent from collecting more fairy.
Oh man, that would be nice.
Yeah, he couldn't go face there even because of the defender of Homeland has taunt as well.
Yeah, he could jump in front and just hit for free. Yeah.
So this was a very strong turn here, but now we can get another very strong vampire.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Vampire and Soul Drain to remove the Phantasm.
Mm-hmm. Where do you...
Or the Ninja Toad, perhaps.
Where do you... want to put the vampire between 4-5 and 4-4, or create a desert and put it between 4-4 and 5-2?
Yeah, I think I want to put it to kill the toad and drain the phantasm and pick it off with the soul drain. So you leave the flower silk fairy.
Yeah.
But I also don't really know what cards are in Massine's deck, so I don't know what his...
Yes.
What is hoping to draw and things like that.
Unfortunately, we don't know because people, especially players, have very high concern about their decks in light of upcoming tournament of the Faeria Clash, so they don't want to show up their decks now because they still will be participating in the Clash tournament and they don't want to be countered by any sort of final decks.
Yeah. So as we expected, he did that play. Now, if Tidwell sits on another Mirror Phantasm, he's going to be able to remove the Vampire now and put 2 4 damage creature in range of attacking the opponent's orb next turn. What do you think about him playing Spell World here?
Well, you'll get the card. So, 2 random cards, blue cards in your hand. Oh, that can just be a good answer in case of being a frog. Froggy Fireman, that would be just insane. But you can just make it 2-2 and then go for face with your 4-5. Do you really want to be aggressive in this matchup? That's my main concern. Yeah, they're fantastic.
So it does the Mirror Phantasm like I was a little bit worried for Mazin, but luckily he does have the Soul Drain in his hand. If he didn't have that, it would have been quite bad for him here.
Oh, nice. Oh, I really like that actually slower deck took initiative in this game and trying to get a fast win over the deck which is supposed to be rushing you. But with that defender and things, do you think that those towns are inclusion based on matching up versus another yellow decks?
The Defender of Homelands, I think they're a bit underrated cards. They're cards you can get out on turn 1, and so you can start collecting already on turn 2. But it certainly looks like he wants to play the longer game here. The Vampires are really good at that. Defender of Homelands are very good for defending early, but we still haven't really seen so many cards out of Mazin, so not quite sure. The Vampires are obviously also very good aggressively.
That's correct. And also to my defense, it's sort of that Salamandra, but it just has much more value out of like placing a creature, but less value in terms of damage.
Yeah. What do you think about the choice here to play the Defender of the Homeland? Is he maybe... Was Mazin maybe afraid that maybe Tiki Caretakers were going to come down on this Phantasm and make it really big?
From what I see, this game is much different in terms of taunt than Hearthstone. In Hearthstone, you can place a taunt and it might give you like 2 turns of life. But in Faeria, is actually 1 taunt equals 1 turn. So every taunt you place is basically 1 turn of life. I don't know how does it answer your question, but that's what I think. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, but yeah, he was obviously worried about taking that 4 damage, and here we see already that it would have potentially been 6 damage, but I'm not sure he would have played the Embrace if the Phantasm wasn't down to 2 health, because he wants to get out of the Soul Drain range. Also the Vampire.
Absolutely.
But
he already seen 2 Vampires. Do you expect third?
You never know. And but he wouldn't have been able to play a Vampire anyway. So he chose to draw a card here because he was... So this Wind Soldier doesn't really help him at all in this situation.
I guess you take damage here.
Yeah, it's Tidwell's turn now, so he doesn't really have much of a choice.
it's tilted. Oh, I'm sorry. I got a drink. It's still Tidwell turn, is that?
Massine chose to draw a card and then he passed his turn.
Oh.
So he drew the Wind Soldier.
Yeah.
And we see a Water Elemental. That surprises me. I haven't seen that card in a long time.
Man, I agree 100%. I was thinking about that. The people just don't play it, and like I was trying to.
So there
get...
we have the third vampire.
Oh man. Oh, it can just get value out of it, but unfortunately he can't do anything more than that. He has no soul drain, so he decided just last nightmare that 6/6 and hope for the best with luck of next turn. Passes the turn to Tidewell.
Yeah, he could have cleared also the water element. So, no, wait.
No, he couldn't. Well, yeah. He could with sort of like...
Did he take Faeria or something? No, he played lands.
Yeah, he played land.
But since the water elemental is now aquatic...
He can't attack.
There was no need. unless that happens. But now this is again going to be a pretty good vampire turn for Massine.
Yes, he can place a land here, and he does that. So he actually... like roughly takes the land, the closest land to opponents, or and that place was just huge. But Vampire came up and fell.
Yeah, but Tidwell is going to be on 4 Faeria here, which means he will be able to play a Tiki Caretaker, and that's going to leave Massine with only 4 health.
Like,
that's dangerously low if he's running Ninja Toads and he has already legs established so aggressively.
Close, yeah. And also these Windborn champions, which supposed to rush through the whole map and hit your opponent, now just sitting and chilling in the hand, doing nothing and performing no value at all. That's kind of a bad side of it. He needs to go... have enough creatures to just block every single lake around his orb. Oh man, I don't see that possible.
Tidwell is sitting with 6 cards in his hand though, so if he has a Tiki Caretaker and a Mirror Phantasm, he might see lethal here in 2 turns.
Oh man, that's Faeria. Actually, Lord Thief also is going to be a 3. No, it's going into draw.
Wow, he didn't get the event.
Mm-hmm.
But luckily for him, Massine won't really be able to deal with it if he wants to take out the 2-1. What do you think? Is he going to take out the water elemental here or the fairy? Maybe taking out the fairy before
fairy,
it gets, because he anyway has the Defender of Homeland.
And also, fairy can just fly away somewhere and gather Faeria, which you don't want to give your opponent. So you probably take it off. Well, yeah, you do. You still have talent, exactly, so you don't really care where to get damage from.
Yeah.
What about Wind Soldier? Do you mind to play Wind Soldier in order to clear out both?
I don't think he needs to clear out both. If anything, maybe take out the Lore Thief so that his Kalim's follower is not gonna die.
Mm-hmm.
Because right now Massine is winning the economy battle.
Yeah. But on the other hand, he has only 8 health left.
Definitely think the Defender of Homeland has to come down here, and I would put it on the right side, not on the left, because now this way another Shifting Tide is gonna make that Defender of Homeland
useless, absolutely. Oh man, that's what we can use as justification of people being tired after 5 hours of tournament. Well, already 6 hours, though. New achievement, guys. We are on 6 hour stream.
But to be fair though, if he spends one Faeria to move this, he's left with only two. And with two Faeria, he can't really buff this water elemental to any big threat, so maybe he did it intentionally here, disregarding the shifting tide.
I don't know. What card would you expect from Tidewell now?
I'm thinking there's... We haven't seen any green cards really, except for some buffs and the fairies. Mm-hmm. We still have not seen Tiki Caretaker. And I think Caretaker is such a powerful card that he might still run them. I'm sure not all of them run them, but...
Yak attack!
Oh, we see a Yak attack here.
That's a pretty big of a aggressive deck though.
It would have been so good to get it out this turn for the fairy procs.
He's trying Mazarin just considering
he gets to put... That was a very strong move by Lucine.
He just can't take over the game out of this one turn. That's pretty sick.
Yeah, in this position now, it looks like Tidwell is in a lot of trouble. Mm-hmm. Messine is gonna have a lot of economy. And we see he still has very powerful cards in hand. They cost a lot though.
Yeah, but sooner or later, he will get this Faeria which is needed. But also what you can't ignore from your scope is that lake is just in front of your orb, and if you just go too aggressive, you might be punished by that.
Yeah, I think he definitely has to stick back with a few creatures. The Defender of Homeland alone might not be enough.
Yeah, totally not. But on another hand, what do you place? You just need to spam minions on it, or like what you do? I don't see. Well, Yak attack will do it for sure. But you also want to use your Yak attack as something to be aggressive with, right?
I think the Windborne Champion is enough for aggressive cards.
There are two Faeria play from Tidewell, and still we can only guess what does he run in his deck, because there is no caretaker yet and we won't see it this turn.
Yeah, and Messine chose to move upwards with his vampire instead of onto his desert. If he had stepped on the desert, he would have been collecting Faeria this turn as well, which makes me think that he wants to start being aggressive with his vampire as well. And now he's gonna take out both of the fairies or start dealing damage to the orb. Most likely take out the fairies.
Yeah, oh man. That's a 100% comeback from here.
Yeah, this, as soon as Messine gets 9 Faeria now, he can put one Yak on the left side as a collector, and if he puts the other two defensively and just attacks with the Vampire and the Windborne Champion, I think it's going to be very hard for Tidwell to establish a comeback here.
So, where do you plan to place your Yaks? First you play next to right Faeria, well, right? Then you place one...
I put it on the left Faeria because we already have the follower on the right side. Follower.
It's roaming one. It goes up and down, up and down.
Yeah, that's fine though. You don't need to have them sit on the...
Yeah, but I mean this lake will be open and it might be a threat coming out of there.
Yeah, I see what you mean. I would rather... That might be a misplay, but I would put one on the left side.
Mm-hmm.
And then just two back next to the orb.
Yeah. Well, that also makes sense. Yeah, that's not preventing opponent from playing cards, but the nice value out of playing those cards. That also makes sense. So
yeah, the ninja toes are really the big problem, I feel, and it's gonna be hard to block all the legs that you need to if you want to prevent the opponents.
Mm-hmm.
You could do it with the yak attack, though.
Yeah, so what are your thoughts? Does he play it? Yeah, he already played it. Oh, wait, where's the second one?
He's gonna step on the legs, like you said.
Yeah.
That's a good option. He still needs to create land now on the right side, like between all of his yaks.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know if he already played, like, drew a card or play land this turn?
I guess not. But
because now a lake could still come down and then Ninja Toad. Well, he's not gonna have enough for lethal this turn, but he's still not completely safe.
What did he do? Did he get he got Faeria for having 9 mana. He got Faeria. Oh man, 8 cards still and 8 Faeria, still not 9. Expecting it though.
So Tidwell is on a 3-turn clock, so...
Well, he will die... Well, wait. Oh yeah. Tidwell is... But considering the fact that there is a champion in the hand and Mazarin has enough mana to play it next turn, I would expect sort of well lethal on the next turn. It's possible, it's not likely, but it's possible, I would say.
Yeah. But in Tidwell's eyes, it's at least a 3-turn. Unless he somehow deals with this Windborne champion that's attacking his orb.
Uh-huh. Oh, and he just skips the turn after taking Faeria.
Alright. That is so now if I was Messina, yeah, I would play those lands, exactly.
Absolutely. There is no other way. Do you Soul Pact?
No, I don't see a reason. I play my Windborne champion now to threaten lethal the following turn.
Okay. Well, you have threatened. Oh wait, you already attacked, right? Yeah.
Oh, yeah, he attacked. So if we put down a Windborne champion, we have lethal next turn.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I like that play. He just played to, like, show off.
Oh, he moved. He didn't move for it.
Well, still it's attack. Maybe he's afraid of sort of taunting both of them or something.
Oh, right. It has charge 5. So yeah, he's still threatening it. I'm sorry, guys. A bit tired.
That's fine. We all tired. People in chat saying that I can't speak in English, so that's fine.
Well, they're wrong. Sorry.
Well, they're right because I mispronounced some words. That was right. Oh, angry
and
yak.
And here comes the angry yak. And that's game.
Oh, Aurora's creation. Another one.
He just wants to attack with some yaks.
Just to show off. Oh wait, it might be... No?
No, it's just for fun. Yeah.
I was already expecting this game go on fatigue.
I love when games go to fatigue. Did you watch the Faeria Showdown that I and Crow hosted?
No. Can you give me a link afterwards?
Absolutely. Yeah. Just remind me.
Yeah, sure. We'll talk about it. So Mazarin wins the first game now, and this was only the first game of their encountering each other. So I need Mazain once again here.
I think Tidwell did a pretty important misplay here in the end of that game. When he realized that he was losing, he played 2 Aurora's Creation just to like make some yaks for fun. But that is very important information now for the second game.
Man.
His opponent will know that there are Aurora's Creations in his deck, which is very, very important knowledge, because then you can usually, when you see, okay, he has played 3 times of any card, then you think, all right, there can't be another one in this deck. But in this case, he could Aurora's Creation on, for example, a Mirror Phantasm to deal with a Azurai or some other big threat. And that is actually a lot... It's a big deal, is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah,
I don't think he should have revealed his hand there.
I 100% agree on it. It's known cases in competitive Hearthstone where player especially did not show off his Jaraxxus when he has little in it, with it. You know, you can just play Jaraxxus and win the game, but he decides not to play Jaraxxus, extend the game on a couple of turns, but keep that information away from your opponent.
Yeah, I think information is so key in these games. So I haven't watched so much of professional Hearthstone, but and I know that obviously information is very important.
Absolutely. And I guess I'll need to leave you for 2 minutes and I'll come back.
All right.
Can you handle it alone for a while?
Absolutely. And here we see already Tidwell. We see the Tiki Caretaker that we were, or that I was expecting last game many times already. And I think he's just gonna go straight for it. I mean, it's pretty obvious here now when we see all these land placement, but with this Verduran Force, Tiki Caretaker, Eldwood Embrace, I think it's gonna be quite hard for Messine to deal with this. I'm also expecting the Faeria to come out here in the back to start collecting Faeria if he draws an event. And yeah, that's what he does. So Messine can potentially deal with this enormous Verduran Force by playing a Last Nightmare, but even if he could, I'm not sure if he would do it now, because the Verduran Force poses no threat at the moment, except that it will allow Tidwell to get land on the right side of this little tunnel here. But I don't know if Messine feels that that's a big enough threat to already spend the Last Nightmare to remove the Verduran Force. Now, on the other hand, it's gonna threat to attack the orb, so if he has one, I expect him to play it. That's something I like to talk about when I help players learn how to play Faeria. That you should always hold on to cards until they have an immediate impact on the board. So, yeah, here we see the Last Nightmare, and I think there's a pretty good chance that Messine had it already earlier, but because of the big creature posing no threat, it could not collect Faeria, it could not kill any of Messine's creature, or it could not damage his orb. He chose to keep it in his hand to... for multiple reasons. You want to deny your opponent the information that you have the answers, and you want to maybe remove them instead after they have been buffed. But I don't think there was no reason for Tidwell to buff the Verduran Force in this situation.
I'm back. Yeah, I'm here.
Welcome back.
Thanks.
So we saw so far Tidwell play a Verduran force to threaten Messine very early, but the last nightmare took it out.
Okay. Our Rin's command is might be pretty essential in this matchup because of healing.
Yeah, what do you think it's gonna do here? I'm expecting actually.
I'm expecting lake.
Yeah, I think a lake now next to the Faeria, on the top left.
Yeah.
So that next turn you can play a lake, farther back to jump and collect Faeria and kill the follower to deny Messine's.
Messine's economy. Yeah.
Yeah, and he might even play a Tiki caretaker on the forward forest. Because then he can step onto the lake the following turn that he creates this turn. That's what I would do, I think. But he might want to save the Tiki caretaker for later, but I think it's important for him to get something to start collecting Faeria as well.
Yeah, but you're also giving up the buff of caretaker. So you're playing it as 4-4, but this 4-4 will be collecting. This creature will not fight, but in case of emergency, yes, it can go back and forth, collect Faeria if needed.
The good thing about that play is it wouldn't be in in danger.
Did you mean exact this spot or lower one?
This is the one I meant before I started talking about the Tiki caretaker, because now he has a very good position for future ninja toads.
Yes.
But if he had chosen to play the Tiki caretaker, alright, so in this situation it's very good that he, because now we can take out the Skyguard. I think he's gonna ninja toad and Tiki caretaker here.
Into trade, yeah.
I think so.
Well, yeah, you need to. If you don't do that, say you do nothing, he will take 3 Faeria next turn and 4 Faeria following.
Yeah, you can't really
afford that.
Allow that.
Here's the. What can you say about that caretaker positioning? Is that okay from your perspective?
Well, it's far more vulnerable to vampires, for example.
Yes.
But I think it's a very good position still. He has Runin's Command and Elderwood Embrace, so he can make this small Tiki caretaker turn into a bigger threat if he needs to. And didn't have time to mention it, but Messine's prairie placements were really good. He put it there specifically when his Kalim's follower were on the bottom, so that a ninja toad cannot jump over there and snipe it.
That's why they are playing in top 4, though.
Yeah, they're certainly good players. And I actually got a message now from Turtle, I have access to their deck list.
Oh, nice. So you can give us inside information, though. But guys, keep it secret.
Yeah. Should I even talk about it, or should we keep it exciting for the viewers? Sometimes as a viewer, I think it's nice when you don't really know what can happen. But
I agree on it. Yeah, but my terms mostly stay on the fact that players just need to keep their deck secret for the tournament. So if you just announce their deck choices, that might be not that great of a deal for them on the following tournament.
Yeah. So what do you think about this here? He chose here to deal one less damage, but he instead has 4 health on his toad, which is a very big deal because of vampires, because of soul drains.
Soul drain, that was exactly the reasoning behind it.
I think a lot of lesser players would do a different trade there because they think, oh, one extra damage. But this was certainly the right move.
Is going to take it off.
Yeah, he's going to clear the entire board here, which is Which leaves Tidwell with nothing, and Messine with a very strong economy.
But he has lore. Oh, I mean, Tidwell has lore, so he will surely draw with that. And maybe we'll try to encounter this 0-1 Kalim on the right side.
Yeah. The problem with doing that is at this time, I think Messine feel like he has pretty good control over the game and he might want to start being aggressive. And if he puts his lore thief in the lower right lake here, which would be a very good draw choice, since Kalim's follower is gonna want to move down next turn, but it's just gonna make Messine feel even better about placing an aggressive vampire up there, because it's gonna grow and take out the Lord Thief at the same time. He might also play the fairy.
No, he doesn't, unfortunately.
And he wants to play the fairy at the same time he plays the Lord Thief.
Messine just snowballs with that fairy wells, and we'll see another take off from the defending position.
Yeah.
Oh man, Messine is so good on coming back though.
Yeah, I think not from looking at the deck list, I actually still didn't look at them, I just saw that I received them, but it feels like Tidwell's deck is more about finishing the game early, while Messine has a lot of ways of staying alive and mounting a stronger attack later on.
So basically that's the fight of classic things that in every game ever made, the guy who is trying to attack tries to attack efficiently, and guy another supposed to be extending his lifetime and winning over the time passes.
And we see Tyrwell drawing a windfall from his spell world, and that's definitely not the card he was looking for.
Yeah, that's just give you 3 Faeria when you already have 10, so really care.
Yeah, he's not gonna be in the position, I think, to save up that much Faeria.
Yeah. He can gather 9 Faeria out of this structure, but on the other hand, it's already 7-4 close to 7-6 because of vampire. Oh, I'm sorry.
This is really awkward now for Tidwell because he's not going to be able to move his fairy into a position to collect Faeria. But if it stays, it's just going to die.
I think it's going to die. Oh yeah, of course it's taunted. Sure. Oh, he's going to take it off. No. Actually, no, he's defending with his soldier, wind soldier. Yes, soldier, yeah. Oh man, he's drawn card, but Garbrian commander on top deck, but it's a Quantic, and you don't have this much of lakes here.
Yeah, that's not really the cards he wants in the situation. The Sunken Tower might come into play, actually, because...
Yeah, you can
Not because of the effect, but it's at least a structure that if he blocks...
The way, yes.
Yeah.
That's the only the reasoning behind it. This will work as a dauntless taunt, if it makes any sense.
Yeah. It only really comes into play though if there is 3 creatures that want to attack at the same time.
Yes, totally right.
So what do you think Tidwell will do here? Is he forced to maybe draw a card with his Shifting Tide?
We already seen that he moved his Faeria. don't know, that's pretty much a play to commander, I believe. How do you play commander here? Yeah, you actually can. And yeah, he does that. Well, it's not going to prevent your opponent from dealing damage to your face in quantity of 7, but at least if he ignores your commander, you can kill off that 7-6 in next turn with your Renin's command.
Yeah, I think there might be another Wind Soldier coming here.
Mm-hmm.
But Messine only has one card, so the chance of him having either that or Soul Drain, I suppose, is not very large.
3-17 though. Oh, that's the last nightmare. He takes off the fear, ruining opponent's economy even more harder.
Yeah. Because he knows that he's gonna take this game later on when he gets his flying 5/5s out.
Yeah, exactly.
We also saw last game that he's running the Yellow Dragon, even if he never really played it then.
Yeah, Azerai was there. Oh man, Azerai also feeds the concept of this deck so good now. Because it just removes 2 damage from all of the creatures, which makes it like gain your life, basically.
Yeah.
And also it plays in 6/6, which will also trade, and probably it will trade minimum into 2 cards. Well, in best case scenario, it's going to be.
Since it drains the creature's life, damage, it could trade into far more even. But now we see that. The vampire is dealt with, but still falling really far behind here in economy.
Yeah, absolutely.
And his spell whirls didn't help him too much.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh man, Kalim's follower just going to rush that. The defender is played again.
Yeah, he wants to establish his yak to start double collecting.
Mm-hmm. Oh man. This game's so intense. You know, you kind of favorite in one guy and then just it goes all the way back and repeats the scenario of the first game, and you're just looking at this like, come on, is that really possible? What's Tidewell does wrong if he always get to be aggressive?
Yeah. Do you think he's gonna use his Sunken Tower here? He could use it in a few different ways. You could either move the prairie from the left side away from the yak, so that Messine has to put 2 new lands there if he wants to go there. Or he could move the desert away from in front of the orb to play card. Oh, he chooses not to use it at all.
What I think is that the only consideration of this Sinking Tower is that you need to have mana pool when it comes to the point of having one. So basically if you put it next to the yak, it's going to be destroyed and you won't get any value of it. But here you can just trigger that tower and get mana when you... Maybe this is the reason. Is it, if that makes
no,
sense?
No, this Sunken Tower is used to move a land. I think you're thinking of a different structure.
Oh,
Blue has another structure that you give you Faeria.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm mistaken. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I'm thinking about this.
I know which one you mean.
Yeah, I'm sorry. That's my bad. That's why I can agree on what you said. It's better to cancel.
It certainly looks now like, because now, for example, I would have move the land where the yak is standing so that he can't collect without playing lands or moving back. It's very minor things, and I don't think Tidwell is gonna find a way to come back from this game.
And then it means that Mazine is going to be in finals with his yellow deck.
Yeah, this deck looks pretty solid. And I'm taking a look now at the brackets, and it looks like Sagittar has already advanced, so he's going to be in the grand final and most likely play against Messine. Yeah,
oh,
there it is.
Yes.
Good game. Very well played by Messine.
Do I have this negative in my friend list? Like, guys, I put this thing for you now, and considering the fact that you already know who is going to play in finals, I'm not going to put brackets on stream, just there is no point, you already know who is playing there, and I need to add that guy who is in the finals to play us a final though.
Is the finals best of three or best of five or seven or nine?
Let me just check it. I already opened that.
It says here best of three. All right.
All right. Well. Yeah. I send request, so I need to find him on. Okay. Dig something inside. How was his nickname? Can you spell it for me?
Sagittar. Sagittar.
Yeah, I see him. He added me already in game, I guess. Oh. Yes, that's right. Wine lobby. As I in lobby, and I invite lobby. Wait, I need to invite Mazine. Invites up. Pending comment closes. That is, we just saw. Oh no. I wait where he left.
Yeah, let's take a look at Sagittar. I haven't seen him play. Do you know what type of deck he's running? Have you watched him play earlier?
Oh no, we didn't. Well, we watched one game, but it was like. Oh, round two, so I don't really remember.
All right.
Alright,
and alright, we have a game.
Ourselves a final. So good luck for the boss flares, and this is the actual I forgot the word.
Grand finals?
Not. I was trying to say.
Look at Sagitter's starting hand, oh, though. Man. This is beautiful.
Absolutely.
So this game could end very, very quickly now if Messine does not have a last nightmare in his hand.
Yes, absolutely.
Do you think he's gonna rush here, or is he gonna play the longer game? If he's rushing,
I guess he plays that sacrificial deck. I might be wrong, but I guess so. So if you play sacrificial deck, do you want to rush? That's the question.
I already took a look at this deck list as well, so I can tell you this much, he's playing mono green.
Okay.
And he can already see that Messine is playing quite defensively himself by running a defender of the homeland. So I think he's gonna just put down the Redurant Force here and start walking towards his opponent, and then when he gets in range, just dump a lot of creatures that are far too big for... Oh, and here we already see one last nightmare being used.
That's not reasoning, I guess. Can you... Oh well, you deny the economy by that display, but do you really want to sacrifice 6 mana in order to prevent your opening? Like, knowing gaining mana crystal?
I think it was a correct play, because in Messine's mind, the only way he can ever deal with a Verdurant Force, really, is by playing a Last Nightmare on it. So instead of waiting to do it later, he might as well do it now before it managed to collect any Faeria.
Alright.
But now I'm expecting the Grove Guardian to start moving upwards, and maybe Sagitter playing an Oakling in the back.
Yeah.
To later on, when he gets close enough, just use Feed of Forest on it and dump whatever got big right into Messine's face.
And also, if the dog gets on the Grizzly, it all prevents Choking Sand on it.
Yeah. And it has a pretty big chance of going on the Grizzly. But he chose not to play the Oakling. What do you think about that?
Chose not to, or... maybe he wants to put it somewhere on the left side later on. If that makes any sense.
He already knows, though, that one... Where is he gonna move? Is he moving the Grove Guardian back?
You kinda have to.
Oh, he flies away with the Sky Guard. Accomplishes the same, but it allows him to collect more Faeria. That's a good move.
I like Mazin's deck.
Yeah. Wow, we see so many good cards here for Sagitter. He has certainly all the tools he needs here to be aggressive.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Well,
we already saw, so one last nightmare is gone. That's very important knowledge.
As I told you, this game is going to be a classic. Just yellow versus green. That's it. That's what we see on this tournament. That's the major part of it. I'm pretty interested what is going to be on next weekend.
Yeah, I'm also gonna compete next week, and that's gonna be the first time I'm being able to compete, so I'm very excited about that.
Oh man, but having 5 damage into your face is not nice.
Yeah, but...
He takes a risk, yeah.
If there's gonna be a race, I still feel like Sagitter will will win it.
I assume that he will.
Maybe not anymore though. Oh, with this Windborn champion coming down. No, he won't be able to win the race. He can heal for 5, but might not be enough. What is important now is to step in front of this other Windborn champion. So I would now attack with a Deepwood Grizzly on the follower, move up with the Grove Guardian.
Mm-hmm.
That way we get taunt. But in addition to that, I play a forest to the left and place the Oakling there, so that the Windborn champion, even if the Grove Guardian is killed, the Windborn champion cannot just fly over.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
But yeah, and maybe I would also use Feed the Forest on the Oakling and put down
whatever gets big. Yeah.
Yeah.
That makes sense, but really, you are 4 of little texture. And knowing the deck of Mazine, it's possible to get little next turn, though.
Yeah, we also know that he has Kalim's follower.
Yeah, would you consider take a running command into hill now?
Yeah, I think I would do that. Let's see how much Faeria he's going to be left with. If he plays an Oakling and then feeds it, he's going to be on 6 Faeria, is that correct? Because he's on 6 now.
Yeah.
I think so.
Well, he'll gain 4 back, right?
Yeah.
Yes. Oh wait, 2 life. 2 life. So it will get 5 back, right? So, yeah, 1 plus 5 is 6. Yeah, good math.
Alright, so now we're gonna see if he has a last nightmare here. That's.
Mm-hmm.
But he's not gonna be able to play it unless he moves back with the other Windborn champion. Alright, so this might be. He doesn't have lethal yet, though. Also, not in his hand.
Yeah. He might draw it though. He 11 damage now.
Yeah, he just need one more buff.
Yeah. He will manage to draw it somehow, maybe.
Soul Pack, that is risky. That's gonna be a last nightmare. Otherwise, he would not have done that. No?
Oh man.
Soul Drain.
It just sacrifices everything into Vampire.
The Vampire,
wow, that's
wow.
Huge. So he almost guarantees himself a win now. Oh man, that's a huge turn. Oh man, this is. Oh, unfortunately, he can't play it. Oh, wait. Can he? No, he can't.
No, that's so beautiful how the follower is blocking him.
Otherwise, he would be like 1 damage. Short, but you would guarantee yourself a win next turn. Oh my god, it would be huge, but it's just in my imagination, and I really regret it. I really regret we don't see it on finals.
Yeah, that would have been so cool.
Yeah.
But there are so many cards Messine can have to deal with the Magda.
I guess you can sit now. Alright, he's eating that. And into another feed of forest. Oh man. And oh man.
Well, so he can.
You can prevent lead on
the Kalim. Did he play lands yet?
Oh, I guess not. Can you explain? Oh, right, I know.
Now we use feed of forest on this.
Oh man.
Now you put a Verdurant Force, but it's just gonna get killed by the vampires, so it doesn't really matter.
Yeah. God. The game is so intense.
I thought this would have been over a long time ago.
Yeah, me too.
Oh, this headset I'm using is so uncomfortable. But it has the better microphone.
Oh man, you just get to have to get used to it, or buy a mic as I have, just separated. Well, how do you say that? Not separated, but
yeah, a standalone microphone.
And then
I've been looking at getting one of those, maybe.
Well, I'm the caster. That's what I do. So I gotta have it. So. That's essential for me, but I'm sure that it's essential for you. And actually,
so this is game now. Sagittar cannot come back, so he should not play any card. He doesn't want to reveal to his opponent what he has, and he doesn't. That was actually a very exciting game one. I thought it would have been over when I saw the starting hand. I was really worried it would be a very short game, but it turned out to be pretty epic. These flyers, man, the yellow flyers, they're so powerful and they have so great mobility.
Yeah. We watched Sagittar, right? So now we watch Mazain.
Yeah.
Is that correct? Yeah.
Yeah, that's correct. So if Mazain takes this, he's gonna be the winner of the tournament.
But we also should remember the 8 card sideboard, which might break current way of game and somehow put the miraculous win for Sagittar.
Yeah, we can see here that Sagittar is taking some time to join the lobby. Could be because he was sideboarding. I feel that even if you're not sideboarding, you should always take some time before you join the lobby, just to trick your opponent that you might be sideboarding.
Well, that's very high-tech tip for the players, I guess. That would work, man. You can just make a business on Owen. Just, you know, like travel around the country, around Europe, and giving up the seminars about how to behave in internet in order to increase your chance of winning the tournament.
If someone pays for my flight, I will come and coach their Faeria players, no problem.
Yeah, I can sell you the book about how to BM properly. And you just
don't worry, I already got that figured out.
But you haven't got my book, right?
No, I don't.
So, my book is like essential for every DMer in the world. It goes BM 12 out of 10.
Alright, so the players are taking their sweet time here, selecting their decks, but now it looks like the game is on, and this, guys, could be the last game of the night.
Absolutely. But who of them is the knight?
Oh, we already see a death walker in the start hand of Mazain, and that must feel pretty good, considering it's so cheap, and he knows that Sagittar runs a lot of big creatures, so he's gonna get great value out of this Death Touch ability. And he has the last nightmare in case he's getting attacked really early again. It's very good to have that in the start hand.
Oh man. They just exchange with lands and skip the turns. Mazain keeps that explorer. It might be very tricky to get most of the value possible out of this explorer. All right.
I think it's definitely the correct choice to keep it in his hand here, because he doesn't want to allow Sagittar to know in which direction he's building. Because green With Sagittarius deck, he has so many big green creatures. He almost certainly wants to build towards where Messine is going to collect his Faeria to prevent him and take over the economy on that side of the map. But because Messine kept it in his hand, he's now being able to just go to the other side and try to get the Faeria.
But now they are on 1-1, considering the Faeria Wells. What can you say about that play of 2-5?
I think he wants to use it to go and protect that upper right Faeria spot.
Yeah, but why play it so early? Is there any reason?
Well, because he doesn't want to play forests over there, because he wants to get the forests closer to Messine's base. So, but as long as he's playing prairies, he's fine by playing one prairie on the other side. But in this situation, it looks like maybe because he drew something, he changed his plan, or maybe this 2-5 is only down there to
protect base.
Yeah, and use feed the forest if he needs to, but that also doesn't make sense. Then he should have just put it down when he needs it. But he might have wanted to get it down while he was guaranteed to get the cost reduced.
Maybe also. Maybe this much simpler than we thought it could be. We don't know, Rylan.
Now we see Messine is on. So this last nightmare that he just did, I don't agree with. I feel... it was not necessary to use Last Nightmare yet.
Yeah, because you still don't deny your opponent from gathering Faeria.
Yeah, he does, however, prevent Sagittar to place a forest right next to his orb. That might have been the plan all along.
Yeah.
That is actually quite important, so maybe it wasn't too greedy after all. Or too early, rather.
Yeah.
What do you think Messine is going to do about this this Oakling? Is he going to just ignore it until Sagittar buffs it?
That's pretty interesting question because, well, you know what to expect of your opponent, right? You won't somehow manage to kill it when the quantity of cards is low. Of your opponent, so maybe the cards which he will have will be spells, well, events, how they call here,
events,
and the last word of Oakling will be just wasted, or you want to be sure that you can just nightmare that creature which get buffed later on.
Yeah. Problem is, he already spent one last nightmare, and the one he has right now, he probably wants to put on this Verduran Force. He also has the option, of course, to put down a Deathwalker that can trade into this Verduran Force. But we know that Sagittar doesn't really have too much in terms of defense, so I'm thinking maybe. The Shaitan Vampire wants to be placed more, or the Deathwalker. The Deathwalker or the Vampire wants to be placed more aggressively, maybe by sacrificing the Defender.
Oh man, nothing.
Sacrificing
the Defender would be great, yeah.
Now we see it coming into play though, that the Boar was placed back there, because now it can start collecting Faeria. But I feel like that was not really the... Okay, so here we see it coming down on the Oakling, and he knows that two Last Nightmares have already been used, and there's still 23 cards left in Messine's deck, so the chance of him having one here is quite low.
Absolutely. And guys, I guess that's the final, and the quantity of viewers there is the maximum, so I will make an advertisement about all of I supposed to make advertisements about, to get on goldgaming.com, just get our Facebook, follow it, follow our casters, follow us by Twitter and all that thing, and big bye to the Coil Game, because we will be having much more tournaments coming soon. I guess next Faeria tournament will be held on weekend along with that Clash tournament. I don't know how it will be placed yet, but stick up to us for the further news, and don't forget to follow Twitch, Facebook, and Twitters, and so on and so on. Thank you for your attention.
All right, so you got all of that out there. It's it's a lot to remember, I'm sure.
No, I didn't remember that. I just improvised that.
Ah, okay. So what do you think here? I think Messine's chances here are not the best, but on the other hand, Sagitar, he has almost no Faeria, not too many cards. So if these threats are dealt with, he might not have what he needs to come back again.
Well, I guess Messine is not that behind as you described, because they both have equal mana income, Faeria income. I mean, they both take two per turn. Oh man, he just ate that 2/5. And probably it will cost something.
Yeah, he needs to do something here.
Got that boost, but the problem is he going to somehow efficiently use that boost? Oh man, that's a buff. That's another buff. Oh man.
Does he have lethal here?
Well, he's too.
There
yes!
It is.
Oh,
wow.
Oh my goodness.
I did not expect that.
Oh god, that's what I call final.
Alright, so that's a 1-1 now, right?
Absolutely, and we have third game for our final. Man, that just finishes as bright as it started.
I love it when the games go to the last match.
Absolutely. There is the tension, there is the climax, there is everything.
Yeah. So, who do you think is gonna take this?
Oh well, we just watched Messine, right? So. Oh man, I don't know. Probably it will be depending on whose sideboard is better and who can use his sideboard more efficiently now, because that's the deciding point. That now you need to put all your skill into your deck building, into your place, and just get there, whole bunch of coffee cups to drink and boost your brain to work as good as it's actually possible, like in the movie called Lucy.
Yeah, I'm taking a quick look here at the player's sideboard, and it looks like Sagitar already did tech in his sideboard.
Man, look at that hand. That Shrine there. Shrine is there. Shrine is telling us something.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, man.
So, alright. Now, alright, so Sagitar is only running one Freedom Fighter, but he has two more in his sideboard, so it could be that it's running three. But look at this, three Grove Guardians.
Yeah, you just downed up defending Modon.
Oh.
Well, those are five buffs in the hand of Nagitar just won that game on the spot.
Yeah.
Oh man.
What do you feel like you're doing now if you're Sagitar? I would actually just switch side and go towards the right here. Yeah, that's what he's doing as well.
place because you can, and also he intends to get a Faeria for next turn.
The Grove Guardian is quite difficult for Masim to deal with.
Yeah, you can only answer it with basically Nightmare.
And yeah, that's Nightmare or two cards if you want to do something else. But so is Sagittar going to put Double Prayer now to start being aggressive? Or is he going to put it now?
Maybe. All right.
Wow, he wants to maybe go for the longer game here. Or maybe he just wants to make sure he deny Messine from collecting Faeria on both sides. If Messine does not have the Faeria, because he runs a quite expensive deck with the vampires, the Yak attacks, Last Nightmares, Azurai.
We didn't see like Yak attacks and Azurai in previous games, so he might deck it out.
That is true. That is definitely true.
Do you consider playing forest on the top left? Oh wait, so what I'm talking about? On the top of the left Faeria well and placing board there in order to roam with that board and gather two Faeria per turn.
I think I would like to put Prairie up on the right side. For sure, to start moving up with the Grove Guardian, and maybe a Prairie also on the left side, so that you can start moving up with both of these creatures. Yeah, exactly like that. And then he drops a boar to start collecting behind the Grove Guardians while the Grove Guardians go for the attack. Yeah, and he also chooses to do that. I think it's important for him to put on some pressure, but Messine sits on 21 Faeria. That's quite a lot.
Yes. That might just will be enough for him to OTK him. We still don't know.
I think it's important now also that Sagittar tries to keep his creatures separated so that they do not get hit by vampires.
Mm-hmm. Taunt is played, but Taunt somehow prevents you from playing champion, so the meaning is that you play champion in front of you and then next turn you just rush into your opponent's face.
Here I would like to see another, maybe a Deepwood Grizzly or another Grove Guardian come down. Probably the Grove Guardian. We might see an Azurai coming down and draining a lot of damage soon.
Yes, that might happen. I won't lie, it might be a case. No, I'm trying to fix the area. It's not fixing yet, alright. Fine. Everything what it need to show is shown, so actually I see now that champion is already next to the orb of Sagittar, as I mentioned before, and then I was alt-tapped, but still I was right though. And I was thinking that he didn't move that left here, or bear, in order to just step back with that and block
and prevent this from happening.
But he just went on top and like decided to put more pressure on it, and now that strikes back to him because Mazarin had the enormous pool of Faeria and he just is not afraid to use it though.
Yeah, what do you think is gonna happen here? Because Messine might have just saved his Last Nightmares now, so that even if he puts down his Grove Guardian to taunt it up, might not even matter.
Absolutely. Maybe you need some more. Trying to make that board, taking off one of them, and
yeah, and it's gonna stay alive also to deal with the next one.
Yeah,
and it still has the option to put down something else defensively.
I guess you do. You just
yeah, because otherwise the last nightmare will just remove it. And
would you consider to place it in the middle? No, I mean right in front of you.
Yeah, problem then is if another Windborne champion comes down, he can move this Windborne champion back.
Mm-hmm. All right.
But that was a very important defense. If he didn't have those cards or similar cards to deal with this threat, Messine would just win the race.
That's right, but here it comes.
Does he have a second one?
That's a little bit tricky. And a Deathwalker. Oh man. So he is on to turn clock.
Oh, but this draw, the Freedom Fighter, is so good. He's going to be able to remove all of these aggressive threats, and he's going to have three pretty big guys in range of attacking. And he's even going to have a 6-1 left standing to defend.
Yeah, absolutely. I can see where it lies. But he needs down to the face, but still he has 15 health. Oh man, he sacrificed that his only attacking creature. Oh man, he drew another feed. Oh, the forest.
Yeah, feed the forest is not what he was looking for.
I guess
yeah.
You can just pipe Tiki Piper. Use the forest on Tiki Piper.
Yeah. I think we're definitely going to see Freedom Fighter come down.
I guess
down,
you
yeah.
just play your cards. You just play Freedom Fighter into Command, into Trading, into Feed the Forest, or in like, I don't know, into like taunting your 6-1 in order to give it more of vitality and durability. Oh no, he decides to play 7-7.
Alright, then healing up this boar is also pretty important.
Yeah, will it be enough?
Let's see. An Azurai here is gonna remove so much damage from Messine, but it's just gonna die directly to the boar.
Yes.
So that's not really useful.
He wants to pressure his opponent, so this turn, this way he puts his opponent on 2 turn clock. He's down to 13 health now.
Yeah. We haven't seen Messine play any... what's it called? Kalim's Prayer, right?
Yeah, we didn't. Correct. Man. Maybe he just acted out.
Yeah, it received a nerf recently.
Yeah.
Maybe people don't like it so much after that.
Yeah, we saw a couple of them today. And people even managed to win.
Yeah.
Well, that's going to prevent 5 damage.
Yeah, but that's really not an answer, really. It's just buying some time.
Yes.
Tiki Caretaker is pretty big.
Yeah, absolutely. Do you consider to play one more forest here?
I would put a forest right in front of the orb here. Put the Oakling down, feed it, put down a Tiki Caretaker.
Yes. Absolutely. Oh man, that's huge. So you play your forest right on downed.
Yeah, exactly.
Now.
And then drop the big caretaker. Oh, but he doesn't do it. He could have.
Why would he? Maybe
he still has. He still has to. He's still threatening lethal here. So
yeah, he doesn't need to show off yet.
He wants to save his caretaker, maybe.
Oh wait, that's
so. This was a nice play. With this amount of damage on the board, it will probably not matter, but you never know.
And there is the soul pact coming, and
so
another soul pact.
He's killing himself.
Into choking sand. Into soul drain.
He just revealing his cards, and that's it. Congratulations.
Yeah, I put this thing on, and I will try to get Sigitur on our Skype conversation if he agrees.
Yeah, this was and we saw mono green win the game.
Yeah. Wait, how do I?
But I know that he is very tired.
Yeah, we know that. So we won't keep him for long.
He might not even want to come for a quick interview. We'll see. Don't type it in the public chat, because then people will know that he won the game.
He already wrote it himself.
Ah, okay.
Discord will do it. And how to use Discord voice in your Discord chat?
You need to join a different room.
Yeah, I know, but I can't speak there anyway.
I'm really not so familiar with Discord, unfortunately.
No, don't worry, we are not making an interview because Secretary just refused. And alright, let's get a conclusion. How are you feeling after the finals?
How I'm feeling?
Yeah.
I'm very happy that we saw these two players, and it was very exciting. I think the yellow deck looked really fun, and it looked so strong in the previous game that we watched, so I was a little bit worried how we were gonna see it defeated. But this just mono green here, did a lot of work. Just yellow ran out of removal.
Yeah, exactly. You just don't have to run. You just don't have those cards, which is well, you all that know, guys. I'm pretty tired, and I can't even speak some proper English now. Some people will talk Italian that I speak Italian language. Well, probably yes. Motto bene or something like this. That's only what I think I can think of now. And thank you everyone for watching, following, subscribing, and doing all that thing. Thank you Mr. Jigglers for coming to Quail Gaming as a guest streamer and help me with most of the streaming. And of course, Joke, thank you very much for most important part, taking care by you of our finals of our tournament. That's a lovely visit. I wish we can make it on every tournament basis, if you not if you agree on it, I mean.
I can't make any promises now, but yeah. I can say this much. I absolutely love doing this, and I appreciate that you're giving me the chance. So we'll just have to see. And before we leave, I also want to say thank you for making this this happening. You've been working really hard today. A lot of people don't know, but it's actually takes a lot of energy to cast and being administrating these tournaments. It takes a lot of time, a lot of effort, and it usually goes on for a very long time. So thank you very much for doing this.
Welcome. You know that it's normally I'm the warrior in the field. There is a team behind my back who is like supporting me. Still, they do poorly, but don't tell them that. All right, guys, we finishing our stream on this good note. Thank you for watching again, and we hope to see you next time. Bye.
Yeah, good night.